Have your way, Lord. Have your way, Lord. Have your way, Lord. We come to worship you, Lord. We come to give you the glory, Lord. Oh, yes, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Good morning.
Good morning.
I am so glad to be here.
Yes.
In Jesus' name. Glad to be here in Jesus' name. Now, you're going to have to overlook me this morning.
Go ahead.
Because, I might get a little loud.
That's all right. That's all right.
That's me.
Yeah, yeah.
That's my verse.
Yeah.
It ain't just when I come here doing it in my own house.
Yeah.
And I believe in lifting a whole voice unto the Lord.
Yeah.
I believe in lifting my voice.
Yeah.
I believe in trying to give him my all.
Yeah.
So come on in the dark.
Yeah.
And worship with me this morning.
Yeah.
Because he brought us here. Not was our own, but he brought us here.
Yeah,
he woke
yeah.
us up this morning, gave us a mind to come to worship in this sanctuary.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Right here in Central School, but it's the sanctuary of Christ Disciple Church. So thank you, Father. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Praise you, the Lord. I will praise the Lord with my whole heart. In the assembly of the upright and in the congregation, the works of the Lord are great. Amen. Hallelujah. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving. With prayer. And into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him. And bless his name. For the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting. And his truth endureth to all generations. Hallelujah. So praise ye the Lord.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Praise God in his sanctuary.
Praise him.
Praise him in the firmament of his power.
Praise him.
Praise him for his mighty acts.
Yes.
And I don't know about you, but I know you do too. I can't speak for you. I can only speak for Lily. God's mighty acts and works in my life.
Yes.
As I look back over my life.
Yes.
I have to give him the glory. What he's done for me.
Yes.
Not only that, what he's done for me right now.
Glory.
Oh, Lord, oh, Lord, oh, Lord.
Yes.
Yes. Oh!
Yes.
How he keeps me.
Yes.
How he visits me in the midnight hour.
Yes.
When I might feel all alone.
Yes.
But he visits me and let me know that it's all right.
Yes, all right.
Yes, Lord, he's my healer. My deliverer, my keeper, my all in all.
Yes.
And I know he is for you too.
Yes.
Hallelujah. So let us glorify him together this morning. Let us praise him. Let us praise him. Because when I praise him, something happens on the inside.
Yes.
There's a stirring on the inside.
Yes.
When I praise my God,
praise
even if I'm in pain, when I praise him,
praise him,
oh Lord, he blesses the pain. He lets me know that he's with me, no matter what my journey might be, Lord.
Yeah.
I tell you, Lord, God is good.
Yes, he is.
God is good. So we're going to thank him this morning in the song. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Yes.
He's all that and more.
Yes.
Mind regulator.
Yes.
Heart fixer.
Woo!
Yes.
Oh, yes.
Peace. Peace in turmoil.
Joy.
In time of sorrow.
Yeah.
But even all that I've been through and all I'm going through,
come on,
you know what's amazing?
Come on, sir.
I still got joy.
Yeah.
I got joy all in my soul. Even in my pain and distress.
Yeah.
I thank my Lord.
Yeah.
I got joy still.
Because
one that loves us so much.
Yes.
That has sent his son to restore us back in right standing with him.
Yes.
So that we wouldn't be lost.
Yes.
All but accepted his plan of salvation through the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
So we thank him for us here today.
Yes.
We thank him for his love for us. And no matter what each one of us might be going through,
come on.
We know that God got us.
Yes.
Even in the
come on,
deepest,
come on,
whatever we go through.
Yes.
When we know that God got us.
Yes. Yes.
Amen.
He gives us
yes.
the strength to stand
yes.
to move through all those things that we do on a daily basis. It's him.
Yes.
It's him.
Amen.
So as we prepare to go to the throne of grace, I'm going to pray. I can pray for us.
Yes.
But your prayer is your prayer.
Yes.
Whatever you need to talk to the Lord about
Amen.
Today. So as we come to the throne of grace right now, yes. and let us talk to the Lord in prayer. Yes. Father God, I love you.
Yes.
And I thank you,
thank you
for bringing me this far yes. along the way. And truly, as I look back over Lily's life,
yes, yes.
I thank you
thank
for all that you've done for me, for my family along the way, Lord, even when I didn't recognize. But I thank you that I came into the marvelous light. And I thank you, Father, for your great love toward us. And as I come, we come, Lord, please forgive me. Forgive us any sins we commit.
Yes, yes.
That we might cleanse our hearts. That we might come to you, Lord. And spirit and truth.
Yes.
And I thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
Lord God, I ask your blessings upon this Christ Disciples yes. Baptist Church body. Yes. All those that are gathered here right now, those that are to come, and those that can't come, that are shown in, Lord, have mercy.
Yes.
Your grace and mercy abound, dear Father. And all those that are here, Lord, whatever they come to you with, whatever's on their hearts, Lord,
yes.
Lord God, touch and have mercy.
Yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord, and teach us to pray, Lord.
Yes.
As we come to you, Lord, teach us to pray, Lord,
yes.
the way you want us to go.
Yes.
And Lord, as we come to you, Lord, your will be done, Lord.
Yes.
Your will.
Yes.
Let us accept whatever your will is, Lord,
yes.
because we know you got us, Lord. We know that you love us, Lord. So we thank you, Father.
Thank you, Lord.
Bless, Lord, today.
Yes.
Give us your strength and your courage, Lord, keep on. And let us encourage one another. Sisters and brothers in Christ. So we thank you, Lord, for right now, Father God. Thank you for Christ Disciples Baptist Church. Thank you, Father God, for what you're going to do, what you're doing. Bless everybody that's here, Lord. You know what each one of us need, Lord. So we thank you, Father God. In the mighty name of our Lord and Savior Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Yes, yes, Lord. I got a testimony. I know you got a testimony.
Yes.
All of us got a testimony.
Yes.
All
of us.
And I got a testimony. Hey! Yes, sir. Yes.
Yeah.
Praise his name. Yes.
Right now, all coming in.
Yes.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Lord.
Yes. All that's gathered here.
Yes.
Yes. They go say we on that way, Lord.
Yes.
Bless you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
Christ is like this.
Yes.
Lord, we come pray in.
Yes.
So beautiful, Lord.
Yes.
These men that you called out of darkness.
Yes.
And the old mothers once in life, Lord.
Keep them, Lord.
Guide them, Lord.
Yes.
Let their hearts continue to thirst after you.
Yes.
Let they love, may fulfill the calling that you called them to. May they give guided light, Lord, in this world. Their homes, their communities, jobs, wherever they try.
Yes.
Let us see you in them, Lord.
Yes.
So we thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you for the youth, Lord.
Oh, yes.
One day then.
Oh, yes.
To your guided light.
Yes, Lord.
To the young.
Yes, Lord.
And to the young boys, Lord.
Oh, yes.
That they too might love you, Lord, with their whole heart.
Yes.
That they might call on you, Lord, anytime.
Yes.
They keep you in their hearts, Lord.
Yes.
Yes, Lord. Thank you, Father. Bless the baby boys, Father God.
Yes.
Yes. Lord, it's true, Lord. We don't be selfish.
Yes.
Lord, pray for all men, Lord.
Yes.
Everywhere.
Yes. Everywhere.
But you call men.
Yes.
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 Lord.
Yes.
Lord.
Yes.
Lord. Bless them, Lord.
Yes.
Bless our kindred, Lord.
Yes.
Bless our sons.
Yes.
Grandsons.
Yes.
Our nephews, our cousins, our friends, Lord.
Yes.
Bless
yes.
Us, Lord. Bless
yes.
Us, Lord. Bring you amongst them, Lord. And they may see us and glorify you, Lord.
Yes.
Guide us, Lord, and glorify you, Lord.
Yes.
Lord, thank you right now.
Yes.
Lord, if any man standing here, and he's something special.
No.
So we ask you to minister, Lord.
Bless
in the mighty name of Jesus.
Yeah. Spirit clearly says that in the latter times, some people will turn away from the faith. They will pay attention to spirits that deceive and to the teaching of demons.
They will be controlled by the presence of lying and all consciousness will deceive you.
They will prohibit marriage and eating foods that God created, and he intended them to be accepted with thanksgiving by those who are faithful and have come to know the truth.
Everything that has been created by God is good, and nothing that is received with thanksgiving should be rejected.
These things are made holy by God's word and prayer.
If you point these things out to the believers, you will be a good servant of Christ Jesus, who has been trained by the words of faith and the good teaching that you carefully follow.
But stay away from the godless myths that are passed down from the older women.
Train yourself for a holy life.
While physical training has some value, training in holy living is useful for everything. It has promise for this life now and the life to come.
This saying is reliable and deserves complete acceptance.
We work and struggle for this. Our hope is set on the living God, who is the Savior of all people, especially those who believe.
Command these things, teach them.
Thank you. shake hands.
Yes.
God is good.
Ain't no shake hands, you guys. At this time, we would like to formally welcome all visitors. I don't see any visitors' faces, but just in case, any visitors in the house. All family, welcome home, family.
Yes.
People for war. Specifically, he says men. And so, as he's choosing these men, he's not just going through and saying, all males meet me up front and prepare for battle. Notice that Moses said, on tomorrow, literally the next day, I'm going to go out and you're going to fight with Amalek. And so he had 24 hours to prepare his troops. And so he had to be selective in his choice of men. He had to have men that were able and willing to go out and fight with Amalek. And I don't know about you, but everybody can't always go into battle with you. We tend to think that because we call someone brother or sister, or we call someone friend, that when the going gets tough, those people will be right there with you. Everybody ain't made for battle. Now, just because everybody's not made for battle, doesn't mean that everybody doesn't have a part within the battle. And so, as he selected out those that were able to fight with Amalek, what would be the work of those that were left behind as they were being defended? Now, I think it goes without saying that since these are people that God is introducing himself to, right? And he's chosen those that are going out to battle, their responsibilities would be to support them, right? And so they would be intercessors in a sense that they would help those that were wounded, that they would prepare the tools that they needed for battle. But let's go one step further. When we're in spiritual battle, if you're not on the front line in the battle in the church, your responsibility is to pray for those who are in battle.
Yeah, right.
The best thing you can do is not always to be a physical part of an altercation, but sometimes your responsibility can be the greater part of that battle. And going to God in behest of those that were going out who could possibly lose their lives. And so everyone has a part to play in this battle with Amalek. There'll be those who will fight and from a physical standpoint, but from a spiritual standpoint, they needed those to intercede on their behalf with God so that they could win this war. And we'll see how important that becomes as we go along. And so his instructions to select out men, to get those men ready, to train them, and then to prepare to subdue the enemy. Now, as the people were interceding, Moses let Joshua in on this, saying that I'm going to go and stand on a hill. And I'm going to stand on the hill with the rod of God.
Uh-huh.
Now, Moses had done many signs and wonders with the rod of God. And so the children of Israel had learned to understand that this rod was a representation of who God was. Just like the pillar of cloud that led them by day and the pillar of fire that led them by night, God often uses representative things for us to visibly see and catch on so that we will know that he's present with us. As new believers, one of the things he gives us is an unction in our spirit. There's a burning, there's a willing desire to want to do all that we can to please God. And as we continue in our faith and we begin to build in our faith and read the word, we learn to depend less upon the feeling of things and we learn to operate in faith. Understanding that we don't need to physically see God or a representation of God to know that he's always with us and that he's always standing by our side to defend us. But here it's still early with the children of Israel. And so the rod of God, they knew that when Moses wielded the rod, things would happen. As a matter of fact, darkness had overcome Egypt when Moses wielded the rod. The Red Sea divided itself, and the water stood up as walls on either side of them as they crossed the Red Sea when Moses wielded the rod. Moses took the rod and he touched the rock, and water came out of the rock so that they could be satisfied with the nourishment that they needed. Fowls fell from the sky so that the children of Israel could have their nourishment, their daily food supply, when Moses wielded the rod. And so this rod was a representation of the power of God in the hands of his leader, Moses. Yeah. Now, Moses, being the leader, had to position himself for victory. And so Moses stood atop of a hill where the battle was taking place. And he raised his hands with the rod of God towards heaven as they began to fight. Now, when we're in worship, what's one of the things that we do in worship? We raise our hands in acknowledgement of the awesomeness of who God is, and in honor of his power and his might, because of what he has done for us. And sometimes it's an involuntary thing that when you begin to lose yourself in who God is and what he's done for you, your hands automatically raise up and you prostrate yourself before him. And so it's almost like giving God the respect that he's due. Yeah. And the word says that as Moses raised his hands with the rod above his head, that as Israel fought Amalek, Israel began to prevail. But now, just because Moses had the rod in his possession didn't guarantee his victory or the victory of the Israelites. Oftentimes, we believe as children of God that just because I'm on the right side, things are automatically going to work out in my favor. We think that because I've given my life to Christ, then all of my pain should subside. That I should no longer be broke. That health and wealth are mine. I shouldn't have to suffer anymore. As a matter of fact, I believe that because God is my maker and he's adopted me into his family, that the troubles that everyone else has in the world, I shouldn't experience. But God doesn't teach us that, does he? One of the things that we do is we begin to become comfortable with God. We forget who God is, and we forget that it is actually God's power that is keeping us. And you know what happens when that happens? We begin to experience not defeat in the sense that we are beaten or downtrodden, but we lose our connection with God in the sense that we take his presence for granted. We believe that we don't have a part to play in this battle. And the word says that even though Moses had this rod, which was representative of the presence and the power of God in his hand, that Moses was still feeble and weak. Now, aside from the tools that God gives us to navigate this life, you and I have nothing to offer God except ourselves. Everything that God needs for us to fulfill our purpose in this life, he gives us. The only tools that work in this battle are the tools that God gives us. Some of those are inherent. Some of those he gives on occasion for whatever the fight is going to be, or the occasion, or the purpose is. But in this instance, Moses found out that the vessel or the instrument is just that, an instrument. And there came a time where this great leader who had led these people by the power of God, he was unable to sustain his position atop of the hill, holding his hands up. The word says that his arms became heavy.
Yeah.
And as they began to droop and fall down, then the tide of the battle would turn. Amalek began to win the battle. What then happened? It says that Aaron and Hur positioned themselves alongside their leader. They put themselves in a position to lift up their leader.
Yeah.
Now, we don't even begin to have to talk about how important it is, your support is to your leaders. A lot of times we forget that our leaders are those who are interceders for us. And we began to put more burden on them than they should have to carry. Oftentimes, leaders forget that we are interceders and that we are not God. And we try to take on the problems and the pains of the people and think that there's something in us that we have to offer to deliver people out of their woes. And what happens is your leaders begin to break down because they have lost sight of who they are in the scheme of things. So many times we hear about leaders falling, not just to illnesses or sicknesses or losing the faith of the people because of their inability to do something, but they lose faith and they fall into sin because they don't have adequate support. Aaron and Hur were there, and Aaron, we know, because his position from before alongside Moses was to be his mouthpiece. And so his vocation moved from a vocal, being able to speak, to a more vocational position at this time. His support was not to speak in behest of Moses this time, but he was there to physically support him. And so as they came alongside their leader, and it says that they positioned themselves one on one side, one on the other, and they lifted up the arms of Moses as his arms were getting weak, and they put a stone under him so that because his legs were unable to support him. We have to remember Moses was not a spring chicken. He was over 80 years old now. He had spent his first 40 years being reared up in Egypt, the next 40 being broken by God in the wilderness, and now he was leading Israel. And so Moses is well beyond 80 years of age. His legs were unable to sustain him for a full day's battle. He couldn't be in the front line wielding a sword. He was up on top of a hill holding up the rod of God. In other words, he was holding up the Lord God for Israelites to see that it is God who is the one that is going to win this battle for us. And as Aaron and Hur held up his arms, the tide began to turn again, and Israel began to defeat the Amalekites. Now, the significance of this is like people, like priests. You can't expect people to go any further than their leadership. If a leader isn't properly trained, if he isn't properly supported, then he falls to the ills of sin, self, and Satan, just like anybody else. More so the fact, the enemy wants to defeat any leader or anyone who has any influence over the body of Christ or within the body of Christ, because as I defeat that person, those who look to him for support or to her for support will in fact lose their faith as well. I hate to use this as a model, but we have saw how when there's rift in the leadership, when leaders begin to fail, people are lost. Those of us who are in this congregation right now, some of us had to find our way back. There are those who are lost, who don't know where to go as a result of a rift in the body of Christ. When Paul and Barnabas fought about taking Mark with them on their next missionary journey, if it had not been resolved correctly, and if cooler heads had not prevailed, then the body of Christ could have been lost in that rift. The sins that we see, or the inadequacies that we see and strengths that we see in leadership are often passed down to the people. And if we are not adequately supporting one another, praying for one another, holding and edifying one another, and going to God in behest of one another, then our sins always find a way to bring us down. And when they bring us down, everyone's not strong enough in the faith to be able to sustain someone falling. We don't always know how to lift one another up again, or how to restore someone in our fellowship, or how to adequately forgive someone. And so our intercession is so important, but not only because of the person's relationship with God, but its effect on others that are watching. There are those who are on the outside of the church who look at the church and who look at the flaws that seem to be in the church because of what they see in us. And they're never able to bring themselves to a place where they can experience the salvation and the joy that we have because of our own idiosyncrasies, because of the things that we're unable to shore up and the holes that we have in our own testimony. And so it's of the utmost importance that we continue to admonish one another, that we stand alongside one another, that we are truthful and honest with one another. We can't allow each other the opportunity to have unrepentant sin in our lives. If we know that there are areas that we are struggling with, then it's incumbent upon us as brothers and sisters in Christ to come alongside one another, to hold one another accountable. And that's exactly what our triads do. In our triads, we are there to hold one another up, lift it up in prayer, to support one another, but also to hold one another accountable so that we don't get lost. Because as we are lost, those who would come on behind us, who God uses us to touch their lives, they end up picking up the same kind of patterns that we pick up. All of those patterns aren't always good things. And so we have to fight the good fight of faith in that we have to do some of the unpleasant things sometimes. We have to have some unpleasant conversations with one another. That may not have been the right way to say that to sister so-and-so or brother so-and-so. Or maybe your attitude isn't right today. Maybe we should step aside, have a word of prayer. Maybe you shouldn't participate in the leading of worship today, because you may lead someone else astray. And so Hosea said, like people, like priests. Sometimes we give leaders too much credit. We forget about the admonishment of Paul where he says, follow me as I follow Christ. And we fall into the trap of, he's the leader, do what he says. Now, even leaders have a proclivity to sin. Everyone has a proclivity to sin. We're all sinners, saved by grace. Our ministries may differ in the fact that in the status of how many people we're able to minister to, who we're able to minister to, and that kind of thing. But we're still all human. We're still all plagued by the same disease. We still all have the same fight that we're fighting. It may look a little different, but the consequences of how you fall and how a leader falls takes on a totally different scope. Whereas you may influence one or two people, this person may influence thousands. How many of us know people that will tell you right now that you shouldn't go to the church and get a preacher your money and follow this guy because this is his sin or that's his sin? And we're easily able to point out all of the inadequacies of someone. Yeah. But we never take into account our own faults. Yeah. It's just the way things are. Mm-hmm. When you're out in the spotlight, guess what? And the spotlight is on you, it's easy to see everything that comes up short in your life. But when you play the background and hide in the shadows, it's not as easy to see.
Yes.
And so like people, like priests, As your leadership goes, so goes the people. As Moses was able to continue to lift up the rod of God, representing lifting up the Lord, Joshua prevailed. As Moses was held up, they continued to overcome Amalek. And it said that the battle lasted all day to the going down of the sun. And it says that Joshua discomfited Amalek, which means that he prostrated them. He laid them down with the edge of the sword. In other words, he defeated Amalek in this particular battle. And we see that the correlation of how God is held up in the life of Israel is the same way that we see victory and defeat within the camp of Israel. The same is true in you and our lives. As we give God first place or preeminence in our lives, then we experience a different kind of relationship with God. We experience a different kind of victory. But as we begin to pay attention to the things that are around us and lose focus of God, and we're not lifting him up, then we experience defeat. And so the more we pay attention to God, the more we acknowledge God in all of his ways, and we do things the way he wants us to do them, we experience the complete victory of God.
Yes.
We can experience the blessing of God. But if we fail to do that, then the adverse happens. So as they come out victorious on this end, the Lord speaks to Moses, and he tells him to record in a book for a memorial all that has been done there. And we call this lessons in leadership because the young man who was just introduced to us, Joshua, heretofore, everything that had been passed down had been passed down in the ears of all the generation of Israel so that the children would come to know who God is. But this particular battle has significance in the life of Joshua for who he was to become in the life of Israel.
Yes.
And so in particular, he said, rehearse this in the ears of Joshua because of who he was and what his purpose in the body of, in the life of Israel was going to be. He had a particular special place in God's calling and in God's mind for his relationship with the children of Israel. And Moses then, as was his custom, passed down from Abraham, built an altar. And in that altar, he made this inscription that will forever be marked in the mind of the children of Israel and in the mind of believers.
Yes.
He called that place Jehovah Nisi. God is our banner.
Yes.
In other words, the way we hold up God before us is going to tell the tale on how we're going to live our lives and how we're going to experience the goodness of God. When we talk about banners, you fly your banner or your flag so that the world will see who you are. There's a flag on the moon right now to show the rest of the nations of the earth that the United States of America has been to the moon.
Amen.
When victories were won, the conquering army would stick their flag in the area that they conquered so that you will know that this territory belongs to the Lord, to that particular tribe. Well, as we go about our lives and experience victories, we're to raise up the flag, where we're to let the world know that it wasn't by our might and our power, but we are to tell them, Jehovah Nisi, God is our banner.
Yes.
God is the reason I'm able to overcome the poverty that I was in. God is the reason that I was able to overcome the sickness that had plagued my body. God is the reason why my relationships are better than they used to be. It is all because of who God is and what he has done in my life. It had nothing to do with me, but this victory belongs to the Lord.
Yes.
And so when we raise up the banner and we raise up Jesus Christ, we're saying, it's not I that have won the victory, but it was at an all-rugged cross where my victory was sustained.
Yes.
It was at the dying of the Lord Jesus Christ
yes.
that my victory had been attained. It was when He laid down his body in the tomb and rose it up in 3 days, that victory ultimately became ours. Yes. That we no longer had to worry about sin, self, and Satan, because those enemies were defeated perpetually by our God in the person of Jesus Christ. And so Jesus Christ is our Jehovah Nissi. He's our banner. He's the one that we go before the rest of the world and say, it is not because of anything that I've done, but it's all because of him that I am victorious in this life. And as they see those banners being planted in each and every one of our lives, we're taking over. Every place that the foot, our feet tread, and we experience victory, we're raising a banner that says, Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh to the Father but by him. And so raise up your banners, Christ's disciples, in your lives, in your daily living. When you're at work, raise up your banner. Let them know that it's Jesus that helps you to maintain your job. When you're in school, raise up your banner, knowing that you only have a limited capacity, but God knows all. When you're at home, raise up your banner and let them know that the victory of this family is because of not something I did, but it's because of how God brought me through. When I didn't have it in myself, he had everything that I needed to bring me forward and to make me victorious in him. Amen?
Amen.
That's our lesson for today.
Amen.
We have one here today, anyone here today that would like to take this opportunity to give your life to Christ. If you don't know Jesus as a pardon of your sins, then we offer you the opportunity to get to know him as your victory. The word says that, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever would believe it in him should not perish. He didn't say that you had to do any work. He didn't say you had to keep any ritual. He said that if you could believe that this is the Son of God, and that he has given his life for you, and that I raised him up from the dead, then that would be accounted to you as faith. And that faith would be your salvation. And so you have this opportunity to be able to come to him in faith and be saved perpetually. Just as Amalek will be a thorn in the side of Israel, sin does not leave us because we still have the flesh. The flesh is going to tempt us to sin. Sin is going to take every opportunity to look to defeat us. But as long as we acknowledge God, the word says that he will direct our paths. He will lead us to the victory that he has promised us. It also says that if we delight ourselves in him, he will give us the desires of our heart. And our desires are those that are matching along with his. Because we know he knows what's best for us. This is your opportunity to get to know Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. None have come, yet we still have room. The Lord bless and keep thee is our prayer. At this time, we're going to have our announcements by Sister Leslie Hart.
And pray this from afar. No, seriously, the flu can be very dangerous.
Yes, it is.
And it's very fatal for people with compromised immune systems, like myself. I don't know about you. I travel public transportation every day. And it's tough because there are people on the L's and the buses that don't cover their nose when they sneeze and cough. It's horrible. So yes, if you have flu-like symptoms, we pray for you, keep you in our prayers, that you will overcome it, but please stay home. Amen?
Amen.
So as we keep everybody that we named and you in prayer, we continue to pray for one another. Amen?
Amen.
Our condolences are sent to Rosie Peace and family for the loss of her uncle, Deacon Walter Gaston. Services will be held Saturday, January 27th. The viewing is 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. and the funeral is at 1 p.m. And it's going to be held at St. Peter Missionary Baptist Church, which is located at 4158 West Chicago Avenue. Also, Sister April is asking for prayers for her children, Sharika and Terrence McClain, for the loss of their father who passed away yesterday. Shakira and Terrence McClain's father passed away yesterday, so let's keep them in our prayers. Also, family, we would like to have condolences sent to the family of Donna Osborne for the loss of their loved one and our sister in Christ, Donna Osborne. I don't know if many of you remember Donna. Donna was a real short, thin lady.
Kind of quiet.
Huh?
Quiet,
very quiet. Well, she went on home to be with the Lord. So services will be held on Tuesday, January 30th, at Johnson. So that's not this Tuesday. Okay, 30th. At Johnson's Funeral Home, and it's located at 5838 West Division. The wake will be at 10 a.m. and the funeral is at 10:30. So let's keep all the families that are going through bereavement at this time. Amen. Amen. Can't stop praising his name. Okay. Acknowledge the receipt of a thank you card. The world needs more people like you. The world needs more people as thoughtful as you. For joy is a part of each nice thing you do. You are awesome. Your kindness that you share brightens so many days. Thank you for all of your wonderful ways. Thank you for your prayers. I know prayer is the key, according to the doctors. I am not supposed to be here, but I have another birthday, which I celebrated yesterday. Thank God. Continue to pray. And that's from Sister Pamela Johnson.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Yes.
Glory.
Sister Sally.
Glory.
Can you give Pam a big hug from the whole family?
Yes.
Amen.
Glory.
Amen. Amen. Yes. The new members class in the Faith Building session will be meeting today, and Pastor Wilson will have lunch with the Willing Workers Ministry today. Family, all CDBC members should have formed their new triads for 2018. If you would like to use the office for your triad or ministry meetings, please check with Sister Lula first to ensure availability before you schedule your meetings. Amen?
Amen.
Everybody knows Sister Lula's phone number. Everybody knows Sister Lula's email address. So please contact her if you would like to schedule a meeting, because we have office. We have property, so there's no way you can say you can't meet. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Salem Baptist District Association will be in its monthly session at Emmanuel Baptist Church, located at 8301 South Damon, starting tomorrow, January 22nd through Wednesday, January 24th at 7 p.m. nightly, and then also on Wednesday mornings from at 9:30 and 11:30. On Monday, the Baptist General State Convention 4 Mission Drive will be held. On Tuesday, the Congress of Christian Education will be in session. And on Wednesday, the session will be at 9:30 a.m., which is the parent body and the women's auxiliary. And then at 11:30, the worship experience. And then at 7 p.m., the Young People's Department will be in session. The word of the month is grace. So please pick a night to go out. We also have one of our young members, Trinity, who was Madam President. Her session Wednesday night, so if you go out and support her, that will be truly a blessing. Amen. So family, as I said, we are Salem. Everyone is encouraged to attend. Family and friends, you're invited to the monthly CDBC birthday celebration, which will be held next Sunday, immediately following worship services. So all our members who are born in the month of January, we're going to be celebrating with you. How many January babies do we have? Sister Michi? Sister Sheltrice? And Trinity. Okay. Anybody else?
Antonio.
Antonio, Pam, that's right, yesterday.
Kamari and Cecilia.
Who?
Kamari.
Oh, we're going to a real party. All right, so we're going to be celebrating with them next week. So come with your party hats and your gifts. So we're going to be celebrating with our sisters and our brothers and sisters in Christ. Amen. Our Sunday morning services are as follows. Corporate worship is at 9:30 a.m. These have been our announcements for today. Sunday, January 21st, 2018. We are now in the direction of Pastor David Tripolet.
Good morning. I'm not going to regurgitate all that stuff she just said. Please pray one for another. Pastor Wilson is meeting with the willing workers today.
Yes.
Who is not actively involved in a ministry right now?
Raise your hand up high.
Raise your hands up.
Your hands. If you are not in a ministry right now.
Say that's not triad. Ministry.
Not the triad.
Raise your hand, Angela.
You're not in the ministry. You know who you are.
Right.
You know who you are. You are in the Willing Workers Ministry.
Amen.
Therefore, you will be meeting with Pastor Wilson today. We're all a part of the Willing Workers Ministry.
That's right.
Let's just have multiple hats. Yes, Sister
Lily. They're in new membership. And so how are we going to do this?
Well, they're meeting with Pastor Wilson today.
Okay.
And we'll see you back in new members
next week.
Next week.
Okay.
So you get a pass today. But we want you guys to meet with Pastor Wilson.
Okay.
If you are not actively involved in one of the ministries. We got Salem this week. Choose a night. One that's commensurate with whatever ministry you're involved with. We are a part of Salem, and let's support them. And continue to pray for those who are under the weather right now. And like she said, if you got the coughs and sneezes and all that stuff, please remember to cover yourself adequately so that others don't get it. And those of you that don't have it, don't let this Indian summer get you.
Yep.
We are still in the winter. I remember winter used to go from September to April. Now, Cat Williams say winter is only in Alaska and New York, but it's in and out of here.
Yes.
And so as the weather continues to change, you must dress appropriately. Don't get caught out there because it's 50 degrees today and don't have your coat. Keep your coat in your car. So that when the weather begins to pick up, you'll have it with you. All right? Let's take care of ourselves and let's take care of one another. Reach out to those who are not here. Continue to pray for one another in your triads. Lift up and support one another and your leadership as well. We love you all. God bless you. Thank you for coming out. Good night. That's all I got. Let's all stand. Do we have any other? No. That's it. Let us stand. Prepare to dismiss. Sisters, if you will meet us now in the middle, gentlemen, we're going to certainly be out of here.